Get your hands off of Syria. Don't believe all the media hysteria. They say the whole country is against the side. What about every single pro-government march? What about the character of the opposition? What kind of government do they really envision? It's like Libya 2.0 if you ask me. The CIA is now just sitting and laughing. They take popular discontent and spin it. Wanna see the Arab revolution diminished. What about Palestine support from Damascus? Will that still remain if the country is captured? Clear that the Zionists support the
revolution. We'd like to welcome a regular contributor to Freedom Now, Johnny Ashi, Arab Americans for Syria. Welcome to Southern California, Johnny.
Hello, Didon. Thanks for having me again on the show.
Just 2 points we want to address. We have a full agenda, but I want to address 2 points. One, in the New York Times on September 24th, they talked about chemical truce won't be easy. And in the article, they talk about the United States has been dismantling its chemical stockpile since World War II and is still in that process. And that kind of rose a red flag in my mind because since World War II, they haven't been able to finish disposing it in an environmentally safe manner. So my concern is this quick deadline, can that be done? Topic A. And topic B, Syrian rebels, six major groups inside the country, have abandoned their exiled leadership, which has primarily been the major Western negotiating force on behalf of Syria and these terrorist forces. So if you could address the first question, do you think it's feasible that the United States itself, one of the richest, most powerful countries in the world, still are trying to dismantle mustard gas from World War II and is still in the process, if they do it in a safe and healthy manner as opposed to quick and nasty? What is your opinion about that?
Very good question, Didon. I'm really not an expert, though I did read that report you talked about. I think in Syria, if Syria cooperates, which they will, the stockpiles are positioned in areas where it's known where they are. It's just a matter of who's going to dispose them and where are they going to dispose them and who's going to pay for that. I think the problem might be on the ground, the rebels, not the Syrian government. Syrian government want to get rid of these weapons. They don't have any use for them. Syria was stocking those weapons in the early 80s, late 70s, when Israel was stocking its nuclear armament. So it was a kind of, you know, to in case we get attacked, the Syrian need to have, you know, weapons of mass destruction at that time. Today, Syria has a lot of conventional weapons, a lot of missiles that can cover pretty much the whole Middle East within hours. So they don't really need the chemical weapons. It is a burden on the Syrian government. They have no use for it. They've never used it on their people or on anyone else. So for that matter, really, they want it off their back. And I think yesterday's resolution was a great victory for Syria because it was done based on the point that Syria wanted to. I think the problem on the ground is the rebels. Will the rebels allow the dismantling of these weapons? And that brings us to the second question that you asked. Why the rebels have shown no willingness to go to peace conference. Obviously, that's what that's the end of their cause. What the Syrian rebels want is an Islamic Khalifa. We all know about that. They're Islamist hardliners. They cannot have another secular regime in the government. They don't have a problem with Bashar al-Assad per se, as some of the opposition, which are really more moderate, but they're not armed opposition. The armed opposition in the country want to take over the country, want to replace the secular government with a new Islamist Sharia law government. What we have seen happening just the last few days, and an amazing Fox report just yesterday about the Maalula, and you were in Syria, we've talked about Maalula. It's a small Christian town, one of the only places in the world, the only place in the world, where Aramaic language is spoken. The Syrian rebels, who obviously in that video will show that they're not moderate rebels, they're raising the Al-Qaeda flag, they entered the city. The video titled Obama's Al-Qaeda Rebels said to Christians, convert to Islam or be beheaded. And the video is very clear. They released it themselves, Al-Qaeda Rebels, and they are shouting in Arabic, and anyone can translate, that either convert to Islam or die. So these Al-Qaeda rebels, who are the majority of the Syrian rebels, are U.S.-backed. They are responsible for that chemical attack. And we will talk about that in a minute if we have time. They don't want to go to peace talks because peace talks is going to produce another, whether President Bashar al-Assad or another, it's going to be another secular regime. We are not in Syria. There is no room for the hardliners or for Muslim Brotherhood or for Al-Qaeda. So the only way they can get to power is through fighting. So, of course, they're not going to want to sit on negotiations. So when the Syrian opposition coalition called on Geneva to, or sees that there is no way but to have to attend Geneva to. The rebels on the ground are going to tell the opposition, you don't represent us. You've never represented anybody anytime. That's what we've been saying all along for 2.5 years, Didon. The expatriates that the United States are using as the opposition are not true opposition. They are puppets used by the West, some by France, some by Turkey, some by Israel, some by Qatar, some by Saudi Arabia, and some by the United States. That's why there's a lot of fighting. There are expatriates who have never been to Syria, maybe, and some of them in 20 or 30 years. They all have dual citizenships. They don't have a word on these pirates on the ground. These pirates on the ground are being financed by jihadists, by obviously Saudi Arabia, to try and overtake the Syrian secular government and turn it into an Islamic.
You know, Johnny, it appears that Mr. Jarba, who is the National Coalition of Syrian Revolutionaries and Opposition Forces, representing the expatriates, many times staying in Jordan, in the United States, in these fancy hotels, never once being inside the country involved in the struggle, have lost all support from the jihadists and the rebels inside the country, so that the United States and Western Europe's efforts to negotiate with Mr. Jarbar's forces means nothing because they have no impact inside the country. So what is that? What's the paradox? How do we resolve this contradiction that, in fact, the United States is negotiating with a force that has no base in the country? Even moderate Syrians say that these folks are nothing but collecting a check from all these Western forces, and yet the ones who are conducting the terrorist campaigns in the country who are the ones that have to either be destroyed or put their weapons down to come to a peace agreement. How is that going to occur?
Okay, excellent, Didan. That tells us that the peace talks were never meant by the United States. They don't want peace talks. The United States was, for the last 2.5 years, going round and round trying to have the whole idea is maintain fighting in Syria. Let the Syrian army and al-Qaeda forces destroy each other. Let that's the whole idea. They do not want to go to peace talks. They didn't expect that one day there will be enough international pressure and that the Eastern Bloc is going to rise this much, this quick, to force the United States to say, you know, you've been talking about Geneva II, let's go to Geneva II. So the United States does not have a backup plan because they know when Jarba was put as the head of the coalition, he doesn't represent anyone. Nobody knew who Jarba is. I've never heard of him. No one on the ground has heard of him. He is a Saudi citizen. He has a Saudi citizenship, has been outside of Syria for 25 years. How is that person represent anyone, opposition or not, in Syria? So obviously they did not consider the fact that they're going to eventually go to peace talks. It was not on the agenda. So today, when it's on the agenda and they're forced to do it as part of, you know, an international resolution, they're going to have a problem. It's a huge dilemma. So finally, Jarba said today, we're not going to go to Geneva. Well, why is he going to go to Geneva? If we don't, as pro-government or pro-Syria, we don't consider him to be a true opposition, and the opposition themselves who are fighting on the ground, they don't consider them to be an opposition, well, who is he going to represent? Himself? So in other words, we need to come to one conclusion. The fighting in Syria must end, meaning the supplying of money and weapon and the supplying of jihadists into Syria must stop. Meaning this United Nations resolution should have in it a very important clause that the neighboring countries should shut their borders. We cannot afford to have more jihadists. There's over 100,000 foreign fighters in Syria today. More than 90 nationalities have been killed in Syria. We have the bodies of over 90 nationalities of those rebels, al-Qaeda, jihadists, killed in Syria. We need to stop the flow of jihadists, stop the money, and finally, you can finally say, okay, now if we don't want to seriously have peace talks, let anyone who wants to come in to the table, bring everybody in together and have maybe a coalition government, with everybody, and then go to democratic reforms and try to have an election, start with the many parliamentary elections with foreign monitors, and then go to presidential election next year. So the solution is there, it's just that will they be forced to apply it or not?
We'd like to thank you, Johnny Ashe from Arab Americans of Syria, and once again it appears that the United States, majority of the United States population, together with England, France, Arab League and others are looking for a political solution. Of course, free and democratic elections will resolve the problem with a coalition government as opposed to the jihadists coming to state power and fragmenting Syria and spilling over throughout Europe. So once again, we thank you, John.